Motor cars were designed to provide a new form of personal transport. But before long, they were used for other purposes. This car, with more than 100 others, took part in one of the early motor races run between the great cities of Europe, the Paris-Vienna 1902. And the new cinematograph is there to record its dusty progress. Most of these cars are standard touring models and are driven by gentlemen who are only too pleased to show off their new machines. But there are also many specially built racing cars made to an internationally accepted weight limit of 1 ton. Manufacturers build faster and faster cars by putting larger and larger engines in light chassis. These cars, capable of speeds of up to 90 miles an hour, give some of the most exciting and dangerous racing ever known. France at this time is supreme, and here comes one of her greatest drivers, the Chevalier René Denis on his Panhard. But the great Denis fails to finish the Paris-Vienna race, and an Englishman, S.F. Edge, takes the coveted Gordon Bennett trophy to Britain. The Irish Gordon Bennett is a real international competition, with teams from Germany, the United States, Britain and France. Is over 7 laps of a closed circuit. Only a few weeks ago, the city-to-city races had come to a terrible halt after a disastrous attempt to run a race from Paris to Madrid. The race is to be run over a total distance of 327 miles, and the Panhard, driven by Denis, is confidently expected to take the trophy back to France. However, the unexpected is happening once more, and a German Mercedes driven by Giannazzi is faster. Commonly called the Red Devil, Giannazzi is better known for courage than success. But at last, his day has come. French cars are second, third, and fourth. But the Gordon Bennett trophy goes on to Germany. Giannazzi's erratic brilliance does much to make Mercedes the car of the year. Next year, special trials are needed to select Gordon Bennett teams, as more and more manufacturers realize that racing is a shortcut to fame. British hopes are centered on Edge's Napier. Tires are a great problem and have to be cooled whenever possible. Britain also has new streamlined Wolseleys. The German team is to be led by Giannazzi, the undoubted favourite, while the Italians have Cagno, their Queen's personal chauffeur. The Germans have chosen the Taunus, building fantastic stands to look like a medieval castle, and even translating the inscriptions in the post office into Latin. On this grand occasion, the Kaiser himself is up at 6 a.m. for the start. Giannazzi leads off for Germany. Edge follows. Giannazzi is determined to win. He has been practicing every day for 2 months. The circuit is 80 miles, with towns that are neutralized. Cars stop and are then paced through by cyclists. It is noted that the French braziers move more smoothly and hold the road better than the Mercedes with their undamped springs. It's not easy to appreciate the drama of seeing the giants for the first time. To liken a locomotive to a car, says one account, is sheer bathos. It is as the gamboling of an elephant to the flight of a swallow. It's a shock to the Germans when Terry's brazier is found to be fastest of all and steadily drawing away from Genetzi. Britain is close behind. Italy is also coming into the picture with Canio's Fiat number 17. It is reported that when other drivers wave, Canio, the chauffeur, salutes respectfully. Lap after lap for nearly 6 hours, Terry keeps up his magnificent drive. Genetzi cannot match the fantastic regularity of the French car. At long last, the Gordon Bennett trophy goes back to France. From now onwards, Terry is to be known as the chronometer. The following year, he wins again. And now France exploits her supremacy by organizing a new race on her own terms. The French Grand Prix is to be a two-day affair of 800 miles. The finest possible test of men and machines. There are new Fiats from Italy and Mercedes from Germany. Designers still concentrate on large engines in light chassis. The 14.5-litre Mercedes engine is just about twice as big as that of a London bus. Hotchkiss have gone so far as to fit light wire wheels. Cushion for the driver of this car as it is officially weighed. The De Dietrichs are probably near the ton weight limit with their 18-litre engines. Clement's son Albert is having his first big race on 13A, a Clement Bayard. Numbers are allocated to makes. 5A is a Brazier, so are 5B and 5C. There are no less than 23 French cars among the starters. Gabriel leads off for France. Lancia of Italy is on a Fiat. That's a new Renault. To make this race a test of men as well as machines, all work must now be done by the crew. This is just the start of a two-day race. The circuit is made up of three very long, flat-out straights. It is above all a test of sustained high speed. Although there are the connecting corners. Organization is on the grand scale with 40 miles of palisading alone. As the first results come through, a Brazier is again in the lead with Barrard driving. While the leading Hotchkiss has broken a wheel on the first lap, Lancia, the hope of Italy, comes in. A keen singer, he is said to detect a false note in an engine as easily as in one of his favorite Wagnerian scores. The entire radiator seems to be out of harmony today. The Italas are also off tune. And it is Sitz who takes the lead for France with a Renault. Braziers are second and third. The heat is becoming subtropical, but already the French lead is overwhelming. The first day's racing is more than halfway through when LeBlanc finishes rebuilding his wheel with spokes borrowed, it is said, not only from his wheels, but even from other competitors. This is becoming a real test of physical endurance. The fine particles of dust combine with the dust-laying liquid to hurt the driver's eyes so severely that several can hardly see the road and have to retire. Just before midday, the waiting crowd see the leader come in. In first place, Sitz, the ex-mechanic. And second, the youngest competitor, Albert Clément. Next morning, the race is continued. Sitz leads comfortably, but the complete French victory crumbles as the Italian driver, Felice Nazzaro, takes second place. Young Albert's in trouble. He has to change tires on fixed wheels, whereas the Fiat and Renaults have detachable rims. Sitz's car is not only fast, but he can change a tire in 2 minutes, compared with up to 15 minutes of this. Poor Albert Clément is dropping further and further behind the Italian Fiat. The wooden road, specially built to skirt the town of Saint-Calais, is tricky. Shepard, an American amateur, was fourth. Albert's back, trying to catch the Fiat. While a Brazier is now fourth. The American is out. Another wire wheel has collapsed. And there just don't seem to be enough spokes left on any of the others. Today, no one can catch the Renault. And Sitz waves to the crowd as he drives on with a lead of over 30 minutes on Nazzaro. The first Grand Prix is in every way a success for France. The Renault wins, while Nazzaro's second place for Italy in the Fiat gives a pleasant international flavour. There is a new racing star, an ex-racing mechanic. The professionals are moving in. Germany counters the successful French Grand Prix by putting all her imperial splendor behind a race of her own, the Kaiser Prize. A large number of people still have little apparent idea of the danger involved, which is a big problem on these long circuits. Many who should know better still turn their back on the motor car's rapid progress. This time, Germany has drawn up regulations on her terms, excluding the large French and Italian Grand Prix cars. All the same, there is a strong competition from abroad, and for half the 300-mile race, a Belgian Fiat leads. Then, on the very last lap, Felice Nazzaro comes through to win on his red Italian Fiat. The unlucky Belgian finds that he is now nearly 5 minutes behind. Germany can do no better than third. The race is not repeated. The Kaiser presents the prizes, not only to the drivers and to the designers, but also to the directors of the companies involved. Right on top of this comes the French Grand Prix at Dieppe. The weight limit was dangerous, and the organizers have hit on a depressingly sensible formula, a limit on fuel consumption. It's all done most carefully, but motor racing is spectacular, particularly with flamboyant characters in the German and Italian teams, with the hard-driving Lancia, and that most brilliant new star of all, Felice Nazzaro. The son of a Turin coal merchant who is said to handle a car like a violin. To economize the limited fuel, cars are started at the last moment, and and several are in trouble. As soon as the race is on, all thoughts of careful, economical driving are forgotten. The new formula hasn't had much effect. Two drivers have been killed in practice on these giant lightweights. One of them, young Albert Clément. Many drivers are finding the new circuit difficult. Racing encourages new and experimental cars, but this veteran Cobrombier is in her fifth season. It is not a Mercedes year. And the Braziers now seem to be outclassed. Italy has taken the lead. It's Wagner on a Fiat, and he's overdone it. His lead was less than 7 seconds over Dürer's French Lorraine Dietrich. Bablo on a brazier is trying hard. A Renault is touched by the brazier. Bablo has bent the front axle, but the car is drivable. It's a Lorraine Dietrich leading for France, but Lancia's Fiat is only seconds behind. Felice Nazzaro, with a gentlemanly salute, is third. The speed of this car is understandable. Like several others, they're finding the detachable rims too detachable. Racing has become tougher and more professional, but it's still usually friendly. It's traditional to try and finish, even after losing 2.5 hours. With a fabulous drive on the Lorraine Dietrich, Dürer still leads for France. But the pace is now telling on Lancia's Fiat. French cars are second and third. With only 2 laps to go, Dürer is out. And first place has been taken for Italy by Felice Nazzaro on his Fiat. Felice, the winner of the Kaiser Prize, wins the French Grand Prix. The next Grand Prix is again at Dieppe and starts with a bang. Sulzer immediately takes the lead for Germany and loses it. But it's depressingly clear to the French crowd that this year the white German cars are very fast, and abound now leads. There's no fuel limit this year, but a minimum weight limit of just over 1 ton. The idea of the minimum weight is that heavier cars will be safer. Unfortunately, heavy cars have a strong tendency to keep moving in a straight line. The German cars are overwhelmingly successful, although even Lautenschlager on the leading Mercedes makes his mistake. Lautenschlager still has a lead of 8 minutes when he goes on to win. German cars are first, second, and third. The race is a complete German victory, and the defeat of France is hard to take. This might well be the end of the French Grand Prix, but motor racing is not dead. Brooklands, opened in 1907, gives a great impetus to British manufacturers with its opportunities for sustained high speed. Percy Lambert's Talbot is the first car to do 100 miles in the hour. Track racing is also popular in the States, where trotting tracks are used for regular meetings. One British writer refers to this as a most unsafe procedure. In Europe, it's more gentlemanly. Even if it's not quite the thing to put your passenger nearest to the accident. Amateur sport is always popular in Britain, and at Chelsley Walsh, almost anyone can have a go. But it isn't just fun, and many useful lessons are learnt the hard way. Observe the stability of this car. Now compare a Leon Peugeot, a fast car with a high engine and center of gravity. These small cars, called voiturettes, are being highly developed. At first, people look down on them, saying they should be kept for shopping and local touring. There is an air of the more cheerful British amateur racing of the day, as one of the crew dives beneath a seat, produces a magneto, and looks as if he doesn't know quite what to do next. This way of spending your time demands real enthusiasm. The sheer guts of these men is realized when we see how they try to go on racing whenever possible. Surprisingly few people are seriously hurt. However, one accident at Encore Bridge has become legend. The crew are lifted from the wreck to be taken to the mortuary. When the driver was placed on the cold slab, he is said to have risen up and indignantly demanded his motor car. By 1908, this voiturette is winning a 300-mile race in under 6 hours non-stop. Louis Delage appears too abashed by his sudden fame to thank Guillaume. Less happy is the Grand Prix story. The death of one of the great pioneers, Maurice Fournier, mars a gallant attempt to revive Grand Prix racing at Le Mans in 1911. Unluckily, only number 13, a Fiat, completes the full distance. However, Grand Prix racing is to return the following year with new giant Fiats from Italy. French Peugeots with engines of only half their size and valuable experience from their voiturette racing. The British Sunbeams are much smaller still. It's quite like old times as a giant Fiat goes into the lead round the old Dieppe circuit. There is drama again at Encore Bridge. The racing, however, is different. The smaller Peugeots are setting a new standard in road holding. While the 3-litre Sunbeams come in third, fourth and fifth. Louis Wagner's Fiat is second. But it and all the other giants have been decisively defeated by a blue Peugeot. The driver, Georges Boillot, becomes overnight one of the legendary figures of motor racing. In 1913, the Peugeot engine is reduced further in size, and Boileau is the star driver. Moreover, on the new short 20-mile circuit at Amiens, the road holding of the Peugeot and the skill of Boileau are at a premium. The challenge comes from Delage. One of these new round-nosed cars laps at over 76. The British Sunbeams are again well up, and one finishes third. It is the Peugeot road holding that defeats all others. another brilliant drive by George Boillot brings a second victory to France. French confidence grows as a race for Grand Prix cars at Le Mans gives the Delage a chance to prove themselves. To the excitement of everyone, the Mercedes are back. But the white German cars cannot catch the French. Boillot wins. This time, Louis Delage isn't so bashful. The French industry is right back on top as the stage is set for the last act of our story, the 1914 French Grand Prix. This is to be one of the greatest motor races of all time, with cars from nearly every motor manufacturing company in the world. Sitz, the ex-mechanic, is back. So is Cagnot, the royal chauffeur. Felice Nazzaro with the sensitive hands. And most exciting of all, Lautenschlager on a new Mercedes is meeting the great George Boillot on his Peugeot. The new circuit is near Lyon, and for additional spectacle, the cars are to start in pairs. See how Siler's white Mercedes walks away from Cagnot. At the end of the first lap, it is George Boillot of France who leads the pack. Then, to the dismay of the crowd, a white German Mercedes is fastest of all. Siler leads, Boillot is second. On that dramatic day in the summer of 1914, the crowd line the short, twisting 23-mile circuit. This is a real test of a racing car and of the engineering skill of the nations involved. The German car leads, but French cars are close behind. Boillot is second, and number 35, Durey's Delage, is third. The British and Italian cars are behind, battling among themselves, when suddenly, after only six of the 25 laps, Siler and a second Mercedes are out. Boillot leads, and another Peugeot, 19, is fourth. The blue Peugeots, with their tails cocked high, seem to gain yards on every corner. Boillot's Delage number 9 cannot match the Peugeots. Then the three remaining Mercedes start coming through the field, and the race is nearly halfway through when Lautenschlager comes into second place. Boillot has never tried harder to win. Only 10 laps to go, and he leads by nearly 2.5 minutes. Then, in the last laps, tension grows, and the crowd realize that the Mercedes are steadily gaining ground. The final lap, and as the cars stream home, the blue car is missing. Boillot's out. Lautenschlager wins, with Mercedes first, second, and third. The German victory is complete. The heroic days of the pioneers are over. But the great racing cars will never be forgotten. The fragile but powerful cars that demanded so much strength, physical endurance, and courage as men raced with them over hundreds of miles of dusty roads half a century ago.